Okay, so hello and welcome back, everybody. I hope all of you are doing well. So let's get started again with the hepatology series. This is part of the premium lecture series we are hosting at crackmedicine.com. If you are not yet a member, please go and log on to crackmedicine.com. Please don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Makes us really happy. So let's get talking about the hepatology lectures. We'll be dealing with two most important topics that usually come up on your MRCP Part 1 exam. That first one being hemochromatosis and the second one being Wilson's disease, right? So let's get started without further wasting more of your time, right? Okay. So hemochromatosis was first described by Dr. Armand Trossu, passed away in 1867, and he described hemochromatosis in the year 1865. Right, this is exactly the Trossu sign that we talk about when we are talking about calcium and when we are talking about the other malignancy. There's a Trossu sign for malignancy, and he passed away having the same Trossu sign for malignancy, right? That is migratory thrombophlebitis type of that, right? So he was the one. Before this, there were a lot of cases of hemochromatosis, but it was not defined correctly, right? So this is the Pearl's. Okay, so Dr. Pearl was the next one who described about hemochromatosis in detail. So he found out the Prussian blue stain, right, with which you can stain the iron deposition, that is hemosiderin deposition, in your tissues. So this is the part that you can see very clearly, the iron is deposited, right? So this is Pearl's Prussian blue stain, right? So let's talk what will be tested in your exam. So firstly, this is an autosomal recessive disorder, right? So you need to have two copies of the defective gene. Which gene? That is HFE gene. Okay, HFE gene is the most important term here. In fact, so important I will prefer to write it in red ink. Okay, so this is your HFE gene. Now this gene is located on chromosome 6, and it has two known mutations, right? They are C282Y and the second one being H63D. Okay, so these are the two known mutations. There are more than 100 mutations that are known, and there are basically five types of hemochromatosis, right? 1, 2, 5. Okay, so but we are talking about the first type, that is hemochromatosis. The one, now HFE gene is the one that you have to understand that creates all the trouble in the body. Okay, so the role of HFE gene is to help the absorption of iron from your gut as well as to incorporate it into your transferrin, okay, and into ferritin as a storage process, right? Now HFE gene mutation, what it causes, it gives a false signal to your body that the body is deficient in iron, okay? So the intestinal absorption goes into overdrive, right? So it just goes on increasing. It's a paradox, right? And then the first thing that the body tries to store iron is ferritin, okay? So when your ferritin is completely exhausted, like used up, then goes on to store as hemosiderin. Now this hemosiderin gets deposited in your various organs of your body, like your liver, your pancreas, your joints, okay, your skin. So that is how it is there, and this is exactly the mechanism by which your HFE gene mutation causes hemochromatosis. Okay, and the major problem with hemochromatosis is that iron is an oxidative agent and it causes an oxidative stress on your body. So it goes on to cause fibrosis first and then later on cirrhosis of the liver, and it is also an increased risk factor for HCC, right, hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, so this is also known as your bronze diabetes, because of the bronze word comes from the pigmentation, and the diabetes word is because of your deposition in your pancreas. Your pancreas get destroyed and then the pancreas start getting deficient in production of insulin subsequently. Okay, so the first patient that will present to you, okay, let's talk about some of the clinical scenarios that you will encounter in your exam, right? So this is more increased in your Caucasian population, right? It is increased in Caucasian population. Okay, right? Now let's talk about the clinical features that you will encounter both in your patients as well as in your exam. So the initial feature will be lethargy, okay, and the patient will have a very important clinical sign, that is loss of libido, okay, although they will be reluctant to tell you this, but it will be there. And then the patient will have skin pigmentation, increased skin pigmentation, okay, so much so that it looks literally bronze, right? And the patient will tell you that this skin pigmentation could be due to a trip abroad or due to increased tanning, but that is not the right answer in this particular case. You have to see the other signs and symptoms, and if they are related, you have to think of hemochromatosis as well, okay, whenever there is a patient with excessive skin pigmentation. Now usually it presents in males, okay, and in females they are protected naturally because of the menstrual loss of iron. Usually it presents in males, and approximately the age will be third or fourth decade of life, right? So they will usually be around 40 years of age, okay? So the most important feature that you have to understand here is clinically they will have signs of type 2 diabetes mellitus, and that is why the term bronze diabetes that came into existence, okay? Right, so now there are certain things that you have to understand, that there are certain signs and symptoms that are reversible when the disease is corrected, and there are certain signs and symptoms that are not reversible, okay? So we'll talk about that right now, but you have to make the patient understand as well that there are certain things that will not go away, like the problem in their joints, that is the arthropathy that they're gonna have, is not gonna go away, right? The diabetes mellitus is not gonna reverse. The liver cirrhosis is not gonna reverse, and the hypogonadotropic hypogonadism that they have, which gives you this loss of libido, is not gonna reverse, okay? So they are the irreversible features, right? But then there are certain reversible features as well, and the most important one being, that is your basically the complications. The first one being cardiac complications, and you have both structural as well as electrical complications, right? So you can have cardiomyopathy, and you can have cardiac failure as well. You can have cardiac failure and cardiomyopathy as well. Okay, so secondly, you can have the liver will show signs of fibrosis first, and then later on progresses to cirrhosis. Okay, and then in advanced cases of advanced liver failure, you will see all the other stigmata of liver diseases, right? Like hepatomegaly will obviously be there. And now the problem is that the body doesn't have any mechanism to get rid of excess iron in the system, right? So that is why there is no other way rather than to store it, and then as it goes on getting stored, it creates all the problems, right? You can also have spider nevi, and you can have sparse pubic hair as well, okay? So you have pituitary disturbances, and this pituitary disturbances cause hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Okay, so these are your usual features with which your patient will present to you, and most importantly the irreversible signs you have to remember, because you will be tested on these. The irreversible signs being arthropathy, diabetes, liver cirrhosis, and the pituitary damage, okay? Right, so initially when we talk about testing and finding out what is happening, so I told you about the patient presentation. Remember that they are increased in your Caucasian population, that is also in your Northern European population. Remember that the Celtic population people, the Celtic people have increased predisposition towards HFE gene mutations, right? So now let's talk about how to investigate on this, right? Let's talk about some investigations. So whenever you want to investigate for hemochromatosis, the first thing that you will look at is your transferrin saturation, okay? And the transferrin saturation more than 45% is a clear-cut marker for HHC, right? The hereditary hemochromatosis. Okay, this is the first one. And remember, this is the first one because the second one, and people often get confused on this one, the second one being serum fasting ferritin values, right? And it will usually be higher than 1000 micrograms per liter. This is the usual value, but the diagnostic value is different. The diagnostic value is more than 250 micrograms per liter for males and more than 200 for females. Okay. This is the diagnostic cutoff. But always remember, if you are being asked to choose between the two of these, always choose transferrin saturation because ferritin is an acute phase reactant protein as well, right? So it is not a very reliable marker. So if you have certain other diseases like malignancy inside or certain other acute phase problems, it will go on increasing, right? Although it will not increase to the level of 1000 milligram, that is the micrograms. But obviously, since it is not directly related and there are other parameters that can hamper your reading of serum ferritin, so this is not the best marker that you can use, all right? So always prefer transferrin saturation as the better marker, okay? This is one is better than two. I'll just write it down over here so that you can understand it better. The third and the most important diagnostic feature is testing for genetic mutation, right? When we have certain known mutations, you can always test for those genetic mutations. And we have just spoken about the known genetic mutations, right? The HFE gene mutations. You know what they are, right? So this is the most diagnostic feature, always testing, because if it comes positive, then it is definitely positive. And the disease can be present even if this is negative, because there are instances where HFE gene mutation is not there, but the patient has hemochromatosis. But testing for genetic mutation is the best diagnostic marker. Now, some will say that liver biopsy will also be considered, but there's a problem with liver biopsy that it is mostly used to identify the amount of iron deposition, okay? It is more towards identifying how much the liver is damaged and classifying the disease, but it is not per se a diagnostic marker, okay? So you can understand that this is not a very good diagnostic marker. And instead of liver biopsy, these days people are going towards MRI as to understand how much the liver has accumulated iron in that, okay? So there are other signs and symptoms all because of the iron deposition. And just remember fatigue, that is malaise, and joint pain, right? Your arthritis features, that is metacarpophalangeal joint, the second and the third MCP joints are damaged mostly, and abdominal pain. So these are your cardinal features, and this is how your patient will present to you. And it will be hidden because hemochromatosis is not a straightforward disease just like that. It doesn't have a very single presentation, right? So you have to understand that this will have a varied presentation. So you have to understand from the two things that I have mentioned you, this will definitely be there. So your lethargy and malaise will definitely be there. Okay. Your loss of libido will definitely be there, and your skin pigmentation. Okay. So if these signs are present, you have to think towards HHC, right? Now let's talk about the treatment of hemochromatosis. So as far as treatment is concerned, the first one is phlebotomy, right? Initially, when the patient is diagnosed, the serum ferritin values are towards 1000 microgram per liter, I just told you. So weekly, they have phlebotomy episodes twice per week. And once it gets controlled, right, so it is less than 50 micrograms per liter, after that, the patient can have phlebotomy episodes, let's say once or twice in 3 months. Okay, so usually once in 3 months. But the target ranges for phlebotomy is transferrin saturation should be less than 50%, and the same value for serum ferritin. Okay, so it's easy for you to remember and understand as well. Right, so there is another thing, that is ion chelation therapy. So you have desferrioxamine in that, right? So this is an ion chelator, and you use this in cases where sometimes it is not possible to perform the phlebotomy. Okay, and the third thing is obviously the most important long-term side effect is your liver cirrhosis. So you have to go for liver failure in cases of advanced disease, right? So early detection is your key. Okay, remember, it's an autosomal recessive condition. Now the funny thing about desferrioxamine again is that when you administer this, desferrioxamine helps to get rid of iron with the help of vitamin C. If you increase the vitamin C intake, it helps to get rid of iron, right? Chelation therapy is better when you give vitamin C. But in general, if you remember, vitamin C helps in absorption of iron in your body. Okay, so the patient has to have a diet. Usually the diet should be deficient in vitamin C, because vitamin C helps in iron absorption from the gut. Okay, so most commonly used method, it is the most effective method and the cheapest as well. You don't have to do anything except for bloodletting, although not the most popular method. But yes, repeated venesection or phlebotomy is the treatment of choice. Okay, right, so that's about hemochromatosis. Now let's move on to the next topic. Okay, so the next topic for today is Wilson's disease, and let's learn something about Wilson's disease now. In the same way like how hemochromatosis is an autosomal recessive disease, this as well is an autosomal recessive disease. Okay, and the genetic mutation that is responsible, I'll write it in big letters so that you remember it, is ATP7B gene. Okay, right, and the chromosome value is chromosome 13, exactly chromosome 13q14.3. But chromosome 13 should be enough for you to remember that. There are again more than 300 known mutations for Wilson's disease, right? And what is exactly happening in Wilson's disease? Let's try to understand that, right? So this ATP7B gene that is there, it helps link your copper to ceruloplasmin in your body. Okay, so that is how copper is excreted. It gets excreted via the bile, it gets incorporated into ceruloplasmin, and it is excreted via bile. That is the usual mechanism of excretion. Okay, so usually you would have come across a paradox that Wilson's disease is basically a disease of excess copper deposition in your body, right? But when you test for ceruloplasmin levels, they are low, right? So that's a paradox. Like we just spoke about hemochromatosis, where the serum ferritin values were quite high, right, up to 1000 micrograms per liter. But here in the case of Wilson's disease, the serum ceruloplasmin, which is the carrier protein for copper in your body, is low because of the fact that the ceruloplasmin that is produced is sort of a defective protein. Okay, it is more towards, it is called apoceruloplasmin. Now this apoceruloplasmin, when it is secreted in your body, it gets destroyed in blood immediately, right? And that is why the serum ceruloplasmin level is low, right? So that is what is going on in Wilson's disease basically. And this copper deposition in your various aspects of the body causes all the symptoms, just like the other one. Okay, so the first one that you have to remember most commonly is also there's the mechanism of action, the damage is same, that is oxidative stress. Okay, the mechanism of damage is oxidative stress, more specifically pentane oxidation is the reaction, right? So let's get back and let's understand. The first thing that happens is there is aposeriloplasmin, I just told you. So it's basically a hepatolenticular disease. Okay, why we call it hepatolenticular disease? Because of the deposition in your hepatocytes, that is liver, as well as in your lenticular nucleus, right? So let me just show you. Okay, so the cardinal, one of the most important and cardinal features of Wilson's disease, that is the one of the most diagnostic features if present. Okay, do not rule out Wilson's disease if KF ring, that is case of Fleischer rings. Okay, this is your KF ring. Okay, so this is your copper deposition in your testament membrane of the cornea, right? This is exactly what a KF ring looks like. Okay, although part one exam usually doesn't test with images, but it's always nice to know how exactly something looks, right? So this is exactly how your KF ring looks, and this is your copper deposition. Now what you have to understand is KF ring is a diagnostic sign. Okay, it is a definite diagnostic sign for Wilson's disease. But the problem is, if KF ring is not available or it's not seen in the slit lamp examination, you do not have to rule out Wilson's disease usually. Okay, now let's see what happens in this clinically, how this will present to you. And the first and the foremost important thing is that your serum copper values are low, because I just told you the carrier protein on which copper sits, the boat, is ceruloplasmin. So there is no boat, so there is no serum copper, right? But where does it go? The increased amount of copper that is being absorbed and not being able to excrete properly via the bile, it goes in your, first and foremostly, it goes in your liver, right? And the secondly, it goes into your basal ganglia. So clinically, you will find young adolescent people, right? So young adolescent, male patient, female, whatever, patient will present to you with recent neuropsychiatric symptoms. Okay, now this is kind of a strange thing to have, the amount of neuropsychiatric symptoms. Now these symptoms will range on a very wide spectrum. Okay, so the patient can have symptoms of anxiety, it can have symptoms of depression. Okay, anxiety, depression, and they can have personality changes, they can have behavioral problems. Okay, personality changes and behavioral problems. Now all of this is happening because of copper deposition in your basal ganglia. Okay, now this basal ganglia, exactly where? In your putamen and globus pallidus, right? Now your putamen and globus pallidus is exactly what is called your lenticular nucleus. Okay, so this is where one of the points of deposition of copper is there, right? Now there is also other features, like the patient may have dystonia. This is an early feature. Okay, dystonia, that is your muscle weakness. And the patient can also have dysarthria. So if you look at a patient, young adult, who is presenting to you with psychiatric symptoms, don't be very quick to judge them or, you know, diagnose them with something else. You have to think of their family history as well, and you have to understand and ask them, particularly whether someone in their family, first degree relative, any one of them has it, or somewhere else, you know, you have to look for that. So be on the lookout for Wilson's disease, especially in questions that are talking about young adolescents presenting with neuropsychiatric behavioral issues, right? And then there is also certain other things like dystonia and dysarthria. Patients also have chorea, right? So that is involuntary, semi purposeful sort of movements, right, that spreads from, that appears to spread from one muscle group to another, right? So that is there. And sometimes the features, they mimic Parkinson syndrome, right? So you have features of pseudo Parkinsonism. It's called pseudo, right? So it's not exactly Parkinson's, but it mimics Parkinsonism. And the other features of Parkinsonism, like bradycardia and cogwheel rigidity, can be present if the disease is quite advanced, right? So this is about the pathophysiology of Wilson's disease. Let's try to understand where and all copper is getting deposited and what are the problems that copper is causing in case of Wilson's disease, right? So the complications, the first thing I told you that neurologically there are so many complications. So the first one is neurological complications, of course. And you have extrapyramidal symptoms as well. Okay, so in your liver, you have both signs of hepatitis as well as cirrhosis. And in your eyes, you have the KF ring. I just showed you the KF ring. Case of Leisure rings, right? Remember, KF ring is a diagnostic as well as pathognomic sign for Wilson's. Okay. So you have this greenish gold hue. Copper, when it gets oxidated, would have seen it looks a little greenish, right? If you have a copper vessel at home, you look at it, it's, if it's old, you can have greenish depositions on it, on the surface of it. That is nothing but the copper getting oxidative, right? Oxidated. Now in your kidneys, you can have type 2 RTA, that is renal tubular acidosis, RTA type 2. Okay. So there is increased excretion of copper in your urine. Okay, that is one thing. Okay, so this is what we were talking about, the lenticular degeneration, right? Right. So now when you go on for diagnostic investigations, how will you diagnose it? The first thing that you will notice is there is increased excretion of copper in your urine. Okay. So in fact, so much so that when you are measuring copper, when you are thinking of Wilson's disease as a diagnostic thing, and when you ask the patient for urine samples, you have to collect it in a urine collecting vial, which is copper lining free. Okay, so it doesn't have to have any copper in itself. Okay, that is the most important thing. The second thing that you will notice is that serum ceruloplasmin levels will be quite low. Okay. Right, and this is where the paradox is, right? But I explained to you why that paradox is there. Now serum copper levels will also be low, on the lower end actually, right? Now this is diagnosed, the gold standard diagnostic test is liver biopsy. Okay, so that is the only test which will give you, apart from the genetic test, but liver biopsy is the gold standard diagnostic test here in this particular case. And if you perform an MRI, there will be an increased density in your basal ganglia. Okay, so when you do an MRI imaging of the head, you will find that there is increased density of your marking in your basal ganglia, right? Now that is what is called a double panda sign. Sometimes it's there and sometimes it mentioned. So you have to remember this double panda sign. The point why it is called a double panda sign is because it shows the sign for two things. One is a normal huge giant panda that you all know of. Okay, I'm not gonna draw it course. And the second panda that this double word is talking about is actually a cub of the panda, that is a miniature panda, right? So when you do this T2 weighted MRI of the brain, right? So the giant panda is seen in midbrain, and the cub panda or the miniature panda, mini panda, it's seen in your pons. Okay, so now you know why it is called the double panda sign, right? So I think that completes most of the thing, except where I have not spoken at all about the treatment, right? So the treatment is, there are certain things that you will give for treatment, the first one being penicillamine. That is the first and the foremost treatment. So this is basically a copper chelator, right? We are using chelation therapy for this. Just like desferrioxamine is an chelator for iron, penicillamine is a copper chelator, right? There is a second copper chelator called trientine, and it is moving towards more towards the use of trientine. So both of these are copper chelators, okay? Right. So the third one is zinc supplementation. Okay, you have to give this because it helps in inhibition of absorption, right? Zinc supplement helps in reducing the absorption of copper from the intestines, right? So that is one way to reduce the overall copper load. So I think that's pretty much about Wilson's disease. Thank you so much for your time, and if you have any doubts, please feel free to contact us anywhere, and do have a visit on our website, that is crackmedicine.com, and say us hello on mail as well. You can write us, drop us a mail on hello@crackmedicine.com. Okay. So if you have any issues or doubts, please feel free to drop us a mail directly. Okay. So I think that covers some of the important topics of your hepatology series. Thank you so much for your precious and valuable time. Hope to see you in the next lecture. Till then, take care and have a good time, right? Happy learning to you.